see in your bulletins there, there probably is a blank, isn't it? Scripture and sermon title.
Yep.
Wimpy wanted to get out of town so quick and I think Sharon can attest to this. I did reply with this filled in. Sharon sent me an email and said, "Too late, he's gone. Bulletins are already done." I said, no problem. But if you will, if you want to pencil it in for your own preference, the scripture today would be taken from 1 Peter 1, 13 to 16. However, I will be covering most of that chapter. 1 Peter 1, chapter 1, verses 13 to 16. But just remember, I'll be going back and covering that whole chapter. And the title today of the sermon is a question I have for you right now. And that is, are you holy? Are you holy? Now, when asked that question, I think it's fair that we need to define what holy is. Let me read the scripture to you first. First Peter, verses 13 to 16. Now remember, Peter is not the polished apostle that Paul is. Where did Peter come from? Like most of us, a hard-working fisherman, worked hard all of his life when he was called by Christ. I would say he was a simple man like me. Smarter than I am, of course, but he was a simple man, worked hard, not polished, if you will. Unlike Paul, who was trained under Gamaliel. So he had a lot of training to make his writings come more to life, if you will. So he's more polished than Peter. But I love to read Peter because he puts it in simple terms so I can understand it. "Therefore, with the minds that are alert and fully sober, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed in his coming. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance. But just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, 'Be holy because I am holy.'" Let us pray. Lord, with the meditations in our hearts and the words from this mouth be truly acceptable to you. O Lord, our God, our rock, our Redeemer. Amen. Now, have you ever considered yourself holy? It's kind of a hard term to deal with, isn't it? Look at it like that. When I throw that out at you, you probably were shocked. What? Oh, God's holy, but golly, I can't approach God. No, we can't. We can't approach God's holiness. But here is the gist of what I'm trying to get across today. The definition of holy is to be set apart. For you and I, that's what it means. To be set apart for the work of God. To be in service and worship of God. To be set apart. Just like this chair. Now, you've seen me sit in that chair. Is that chair capable of holding you up? Is it? How many say that it can't hold you up? Okay. So you have faith that this chair will hold you up. Well, is it holding you up now? Right now. And why isn't it holding you up right now?
I'm not in it.
Not sitting in it, right?
Right.
We need to be sitting in God's holiness to be held up. Or the world will deal with us just like the snake. The devil is roaming, searching to break you. And he will do it if you're not separated in holiness. Being holy is important. And you can just think about that day in and day out. Am I being holy? You're being set apart for God's purpose. I have an article here entitled Holy People Are Happy People. It's from John Stark. He's with the Ligonier Ministries in Florida, and he teaches there, and he's a pastor. He says, John Calvin illuminates the connection between holiness and happiness. It's interesting to note that Calvin's view of piety is synonymous with holy living and depends upon our happiness in God. Think about that. For unless they establish their complete happiness in Him, says Calvin, they will never give themselves truly and sincerely to Him. They will, in other words, unless we are holy, we will never be happy. Like Phil Robinson says, happy, happy, happy. But unless we find our happiness full in the Lord, we will never be holy. So it's a chicken and egg thing. If we allow the world to define our terms as opposed to the Bible, we can lose sight of a very few important things. We aren't pursuing holiness in order to be happy with ourselves. No, our holiness focuses our vision on Christ, a vision that satisfies us with every glance and clears away all that would ensnare us from looking. The longer I live as a Christian, the more it becomes apparent that the holy life, a life lived with a conscience before God, is a happy life. You agree with that? The happiest people I know are Christians living that life every day. Even if they're in misery and pain, suffering from something, they're still happy. There is no casual way to say it other than the pleasure that springs from a peaceful conscience and communion with God cannot exist while the Christian lives in sin. I want to tell you a little story now. It's really not a story. It's a part of my life that I'll never forget at this point. I was assigned as a trainer sergeant at the Academy, State Police Academy in Richmond. And we had this school going through at the time. It was all men, and it was over 90 of them in the class. tremendous class, tremendous men. I mean, they were just really great candidates for truth. And then about midway through their training, they wanted to have a Bible study. And they came to me, and I don't know why, but they came to me and asked me if I would ask the captain if that could be done in the afternoons or the late evenings when they were through their regular assignments, if they could have 30 minutes or an hour. And the captain says, by all means, Gerald, I will not stand in the way. If that's what they want to do, by all means, let them do that. And then later on, I'm in my office one night working the night shift, because it has to be somebody from the staff there 24/7 when the students are in. And this trooper trainee comes into my office and asks if he could speak with me. It's kind of lame. My first question to myself was, why are you here and not in your bunk? But I didn't say anything. I didn't chastise him for that, because I could tell that God was speaking to me. Something is on this guy's mind. He proceeded to sit down in a chair like this one, across from me, and poured his heart out about how difficult it was for him to go home on weekends and hang with the crowd, as he called it, his friends, and then come to school on Sunday night and be there all week acting as a Christian. He said, it's hard for me to do that. Why am I struggling? And eventually he broke down in tears. You know, that's a little difficult to see a grown man crying. They're pouring their heart out to you. And I just let God speak to me. He wanted some help. And I told him, I said, you know, Randy, it sounds like to me you're riding the fence. You got one foot in this world, and one foot on the side of Christ. And it ain't gonna work that way. And that's why you are having so much trouble dealing with it. You've got to be set apart, folks. Sever that world relationship to be in Christ and be happy. I explained to him the best that I could how he, in my mind, needed to make a decision one way or the other. And I hoped he came down on the side of Christ, because I can tell you, Randy, you will be happy. But you've got to make that decision and get off the fence. And do not associate any longer with sin. I'm here to tell you, when he graduated, his whole family was there. He made it a point to bring all of his family, especially his parents, up and meet me. Still moves me today. They thanked me for the advice. They got their man back. He was happy again.
Now, I want to tell you about someone else. You remember Dr. James Kennedy? Anybody? He used to come on TV. I loved to hear his sermons. I listened to him on the radio for years. His sermons, I would always try to tune it around, try to find him on the channel, because he always had that smooth voice and had a wonderful message. You know, he got started. Anybody know any background on him? He and his wife, Ann, and they weren't married at the time, but they were instructors with this Arthur Murray Dance Studio School. You remember that? The Arthur Murray Dance Studio? They were so good at what they did that they won the national championship of Arthur Murray Studio Instructors contest. They won the national championship. One night, they were going to the radio and trying to tune in on a channel to listen to, and he came across Dr. Donald Gray Barnhouse preaching on the radio. Dr. Barnhouse was preaching, and he had two questions he wanted to ask the audience, and it got Dr. Kennedy's attention. The first one, do you know for sure when you die, you will go to heaven? That was the first question. The second question was, and they wanted to think about that for a few minutes, but then he asked, if you died right now and stood before God and he said to you, why should I let you into my heaven? What would you say? And Dr. Kennedy said, you know, if I tried to answer this by saying I lived a good life, that ain't going to get it done. I know. God is holy. He is just. So how do we get there? Only through Christ. He came to the earth to be our substitute under the law. Christ did this perfectly. If I took this book and from day one, all of my sins were being recorded in here. And when I died, how thick do you think this book would be? It would certainly be this thick, I'm sure, and filled just like this one. But you see, what Jesus does, he came to life, lived on earth, and his book is clean. Perfectly clean. No pages with any tick marks of any sins that he committed. And so what he does is that he lays his book over mine and transfers all of my sins to his. Wipes them clean and my book becomes clean. That's what Jesus does for me. Does he do that for you? Are you holding? It is not enough to acknowledge Jesus is able to redeem you. You have to rest in him. You have to trust in him. Then when you stand before God, you won't have to think about the answer to that question about entering heaven. There is no reason, Father, to let me into heaven except that I'm trusting in Christ, Christ alone. I rest solely in his righteousness and in his atonement, because there is nothing I can do to make up for my own sins. For my salvation is through Christ alone. When we read in Galatians, do not be deceived, God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows, whoever sows to please their flesh from the flesh will reap destruction. Whoever sows to please the Spirit from the Spirit will reap eternal life. And then in his letter to Philippians, Paul says, therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. You've heard me use those words before when I came to you in November and spoke to you about Isaiah's calling, the fear and trembling when he saw God's presence. Do everything without grumbling and arguing, so that you may become blameless and pure, children of God without fault in a warped and crooked generation. You know, all we need to do is read it. And if you don't like that, go to the computer and pull it up. All of the scriptures that I've read you today came right off of the computer. Very easy. You have no excuse, is what I'm saying, not to be in the Word of God day in and day out. Throw away all the other stuff. Get rid of it. Set yourself apart to God. Become holy through Christ. Stay in His Word every day. I'm reminded of the daily bread reading. Does anybody get the our daily bread? Can you do that? It's our daily bread. Oh, it's a wonderful daily devotional. I love it. One of them caught my attention this month, on the 23rd. It's called The Load Line. I think you'll appreciate this, Frank. When you overload something, what happens? You're looking for trouble, right? Well, it seems in the 19th century, ships were often recklessly overloaded. It's like today, they try to load the trucks, you know, to get as much as they can down the road, and then it leads to trouble. So this resulted in a lot of ships going down and crews being lost at sea. In 1875, a remedy to fix this practice, a British politician named Samuel Plimsoll led the charge for legislation to create a line on the ship to show of its carrying if it's carrying too much cargo. You know that line is there today on a cargo ship? You ever wonder why they have this line? Feed them ship. If it loads that ship too far and it gets below that line, that captain's not going to move that ship. You get that stuff off until I get up above my load line, because it's unsafe. The Apostle Peter said, therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that He may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon Him, for He cares for you. He is capable of handling the cares that overwhelm us. He is our load line. Though the testings of life may feel like a burden to you, heavy to bear, we can have full assurance that our Heavenly Father loves us deeply and knows our lowlands. Whatever we face, He will help us bear it. Did you hear that? So, separate ourselves by becoming holy and putting our trust in Christ, sitting in the chair, resting in His grace every day, keeps us holy. And you will be happier for it.